There is a specific distinction in English between fairy tales on one hand and folk tales on the other hand. I've been racking my brain about this distinction for a while, seeing that in German we don't have such a clear distinction between a fairy tale and a folk tale. Just not the different words, they're both the same thing, Märchen. And the distinction is a little more subtle, namely, after the Brothers Grimm in Germany made their collection of folk tales, you suddenly had something that they would call, or their successors would call, Kunstmärchen, which is an artfully or an artificially made tale, on one hand, which would be the equivalent of fairy tales, and on the other hand you had the Hausmärchen, the tale told at home, which would be the equivalent of the folk tale. But all right, what are those two different things, a fairy tale, Kunstmärchen, and a folk tale, Hausmärchen? The distinction would be one is Kunstmärchen, fairy tale, is something that is being done for a specific audience with a specific underlying idea. Let's call it a moral. A fairy tale has a moral, which is what most people tell you, so a fairy tale is good old-fashioned middle-class storytelling that knows its audience, that provides its audience with exactly what they want. And this means middle-class, upper-middle-class. The tales about kings and queens and princes and princesses, all those fairy tales, usually because they follow a specific pattern of tales and they have a specific outcome, a specific moral, like the poor guy who is a prince in disguise, the outcast woman who is in truth a princess, all of these things. These tales were, contrary to what you may believe, not originally told to poor people, or, you know, to the lower class, to working class, people who believed that they would be princes and princesses or kings, or they had an inevitable good fortune waiting for them at the end of the tale. No, people who grew up in poverty or in conditions that were not ideal usually wouldn't resort to these kinds of tales. What tales they would tell, I will talk about when we get to the folk tales. But those sort of tales were usually told for middle class and upper middle class audiences. Because they believed, as they do believe now, that they are entitled to good things happening to them and entitled to a happy end, and their life would inevitably have a happy end because, you know, social climbing and so on. This is the audience for those kinds of tales. And even today you have people who say, well, this story needs to have a moral. And yes, good old-fashioned middle-class storytelling. That's how you can sum up a fairy tale. Like I said, artfully done, sometimes they're brilliantly, beautifully, artfully done things. The tales of Pushkin, for example, beautiful. The tales of Hans Christian Andersen, very, very nice. But tales of Oscar Wilde too, although he probably wouldn't like it because he had a more subversive idea of that. And all of them have an element of subversion, they can have an element of subversion in them. And all of this is artfully played with in a fairy tale. Now, okay, let's put this to the side for a while. We have the folk tale here, the Hausmärchen, the tales told at home. Those were the tales that were told by families, those were the tales that were traditionally told, those were the tales that you perhaps think of when you think of fairy tales, folk tales of an evening with people telling tales around the fireside, which would happen in a home somewhere, in a hut somewhere, in a yurt somewhere. And those are the traditional tales, the folk tales, tales that deal with, you know, simplistically speaking, with the natural world, with the world of spirits, with the world of karma, with the world of consequence, very simply said. These are the older tales. And the fairy tale, the artful tale, often reaches back to the elements of the folk tale and transforms them a little bit. And the folktale in itself is a transformative kind of thing, because it is the oral tradition that is not the written down tradition, not the artfully written words with a quill or with a typewriter or with a word processor or dictated with your smartphone. This is not what happens. This is oral storytelling. This is something that you listen to. This is something that you repeat. Sometimes you learn it by heart. Sometimes you just learn the major beats and then you keep telling it. This is the folktale, yes, and this is what I, as a storyteller, I am more interested in than a fairy tale. Because here you have something that is an open-ended or an open-source kind of storytelling, if you want to call it that. There are many, many elements that you can use. It's not necessary to put a moral into it. However, what is necessary to put into it are thrilling elements. You can sprinkle sex and you can sprinkle a lot of violence into those tales usually. This is what the people who want a moral, the bourgeoisie, the good middle class people, look at in disgust and go like, what the hell is that? These tales are all so cruel and bloody. Yes, they are, because they are meant to entertain simple people with simple lives who can perhaps not find that much joy or pleasure in something that is artfully constructed, but will enjoy a good thrilling tale that is not full of a moral where the righteous triumph and the evil are punished, because quite often this does not reflect the world that such people who would tell such tales live in. They, like many of us, probably live in the world where the righteous are getting, they're not getting their due, but righteousness is its own punishment. And the tricky ones, the trickster ones, the cunning people are often ruthless and cruel, and those are the people who gain what they want. However, there are also ordering forces in the folktale, but usually they're not necessarily benevolent. Evil spirits that come and that people have to contend with. In the oldest versions of them, they're usually pacts that people have with demons, or people going over into the world and the realm of the spirits. So, we have the clean, nicely ordered, often quite subversive, often quite good kind of fairy tale. And I have to stress over all of this, this is not a judgment. I'm not saying one form of telling is better than the other. There are fairy tales that are very, very interesting and very good, and there are many folk tales that are just very visceral and brutal and good. However, I like the distinction of those two things. You have the artful, middle-class kind of storytelling, and then you have the more bloody and more improvisational, open, lower-class storytelling, if you want. But, as said before, this class distinction doesn't necessarily mean anything other than, you know, help for your memory, the help to remember it. However, what is quite interesting to use are these kind of models. You have the artful and you have the more subconscious kind of storytelling. And you can apply those ways of looking at it to different aspects of storytelling, modern storytelling. Look at TV series, for example, look at comic books, look at the modern world of literature. It's full of such elements, the artful, constructed one, and the primitive, the truthful, the representation of life as it is. So, for this, I think the distinctions between fairy tale and folk tale have far-reaching consequences, if you want to use them as such. So now, this is a slightly distracted summing up of the difference between fairy tale and folk tale. And I will be back with another video some other time to tell about a different topic. So until then, listen to good stories, read good stories, watch good stories, and take care.